Hi, I'm Jim Arnosky. I'm an author and I'm an artist of books that investigate and celebrate nature. This show, Drawing from Nature, is based on one of those books. In the next 4 weeks, I hope you'll stay with me. I'll take you outdoors to some of the places that I love, and we won't be doing any sketching out there, but we'll be looking and we'll be exploring and we'll be experiencing and we'll be understanding the natural world. And when we come back, we'll be doing drawings based on the things we've seen. And I'll bet you that the drawings that you do after you see each show will be better because you'll be understanding the subjects you're drawing. We will be drawing land, and we will be drawing plants, and eventually we'll be drawing animals. But this first show, we're going to start at the bottom, and we're going to start just by exploring and looking at and coming back and doing a drawing of water.
Drawing from Nature is made possible in part by a grant from the Lintelak Foundation.
I can't resist water. It refreshes my senses. It greets my curiosity with a glistening invitation to explore. Water covers 3/4 of the Earth's surface. It shapes the land and changes the weather. Water can be liquid as rainfall, solid as ice or snow, and gaseous as fog or steam. The main ingredient in every living organism is water. As much plants as there is water in here. It's like canoeing through a lawn. See where this channel goes. There's something familiar and mysterious about a body of water. This place here is oozing, just oozing with life. There's frogs, there's tadpoles, fish, aquatic insects,
There's dragonflies flying all around. Plants everywhere, water plants, broadleaf ones, reedy ones, algae, scum. I guess that stuff's alive too. Looks like it might be alive. Of course, me, I'm alive. And the sounds of birds all around. They're just singing out there, singing, I'm alive. This is great. This is the place to be if you want to be pushing your way through nature. Look how still the water is right here. It's nice and quiet. Quiet's a better word for it, I guess. In still water, reflections, well, it makes sense, would be intact and very clear. And when you're drawing still water, that's one way to make it look still, is to make whatever is reflecting into the water, make that reflection very, very clear. And the more you disturb the reflection in your drawing, or the more you disturb a reflection, the less still the water looks. Well, it's because it isn't still anymore. But in a drawing, that's how you would suggest still water. If you want to suggest still water in a drawing, you make the reflections look clear, solid, unbroken. You want to make the water look a little movement in the water, you want to make it look less still, a little wind over the water. You work on that reflection and make it look broken up, less solid. See how you break up the reflection in your drawing. Bubbles are just globes shaped by the air trapped inside them. The air tries to get out, it changes the shape of the bubble. I'm not going to drink this, I just want to show you something. The slightest flow of water will eventually wear a groove in any surface it flows over. The greater the flow, the wider the groove. Every stream, whether it's a tiny mountain brook or a majestic river, is simply water running within the banks of its own worn groove. It's that simple. I can't talk about water so much and be around so much water without trying my luck at least for a fish. Oop, there went, almost got one. Sometimes I think I like to fish as much as I like to draw. Streams influence every inch of land they flow over. And in turn, the land influences the stream. Every time a stream turns, the water in the stream shifts to the outside of the turn. You know, like when you're riding in a car and all of a sudden everybody turns, when the car turns, everybody shifts to the outside, to one side of the car when you're going around the bend. Well, that's what happens in a stream. As the stream turns, most of the water volume shifts to the outside of the turn. It digs out, because there's more water volume on the outside of the turn, it digs out or undermines the outside, the bank on the outside. On the inside of the bend, it's usually gently sloped. This happens every single time the water turns. Now this repeats itself in any stream, no matter how big the stream is, all the way down through the course of the stream. The outside of the stream bend is usually is undermined or a little bit eroded, where the inside of the bend is gently sloped. I'm going to cast right over to that undermined bank. You know, I can see right here, this is going to be our drawing scene. We'll do the river bend, but before we draw, we have to look over this thing closely. We're going to have to look at each thing in particular to see how much we can learn about what happens when all this water, it doesn't look like a lot of water, but it's enough water to push you over, when all this water makes such a turn. Look at this river bend with me here. First we'll look at the outside of the bend. Where the water starts to make its turn, it pushes a lot of sand up from the bottom onto a shoal. And then as the shoal tapers off, that's where the water begins to really turn and dig into the bank. You can see that over there, the rocks that are in the stream bed or rocks that are near the stream bed are rounded. Then a little bit up where the river doesn't normally flow, even during flood time, the rocks are more angular. Further along, the bank becomes more and more eroded. We can see less soil and more rocks. And the vegetation, trees, brush, is bending in toward the stream because the soil has been eroded out from underneath. And then the stream pulls out of its turn and quickens its pace and heads down to the next turn, or for next straight stretch if that's what's next. Here. You can see that sloping bank on the inside of the turn real good here. And that slope keeps coming down. It slopes, slopes. In fact, I'll go in over my waders. Whoop! I wet my pants there. That slope goes all the way down to the deepest part of the turn. And when we draw that, we'll remember that the slope doesn't stop here. It keeps sloping. Now, I'm at the end of the bend. The water is starting to pick up again. It wants to keep going. It wants to get its on its way downstream. You can see this is an indication of the moving water now. It's starting to really pick up speed. Any place in a stream where there's an obstacle like this, a small pool of quiet water forms behind the obstacle. It doesn't have to be a stationary obstacle either. I'm an obstacle right now in the stream. And there's a small pool forming behind my legs. Can you see that? Even the fly, look. Even the fly. There's a small pool of water forming behind the fly that's floating on the surface. This action of the water moving around an obstacle is an important point to remember when we're drawing running water, because it's one way in your drawings that you can indicate which way the water's flowing in your picture. When I do a drawing, people know which way the water's going because of these little tricks. They're not tricks, though. They're observations. Boy, what a day, be out fishing. I'll never get back to the drawing board at this rate. Put a new fly on. I figure coming to a new bend in the stream, and each new bend is worthy of a new fly at least. Before we leave this bend though, I want you to take one more look at these riffles. See here where the water riffles by me? Riffles in a stream indicate shallow water. The reason that the water riffles is because the shallow water brings the bottom of the stream closer to the surface of the stream, and the surface of the water riffles over those obstructions and stones and boulders and whatever that's on the bottom of the stream. And those riffles continue until the water gets deeper. And down there, where the river bends again, there is a deeper stretch of water, you can see, because it gets still. Still water does run deep. You see how the fly, even when the fly hits the water, it makes a little ring when it hits the water? Anything that hits the surface of water, whether it's a sunfish kissing it from below or a raindrop hitting it from above, creates a water ring that widens until it finally dissipates. But if you're a fisherman, of course, any water ring whispers fish. Okay, here we are, and we have a nice blank piece of paper to fill with a picture. It's kind of like writing, where you take your piece of paper out of the folder of paper and it's blank, and you have to fill it with what's in your mind. And when you're drawing, and drawing from nature, you take the experiences and the understanding that you got while you were out there, and you somehow get it on the paper. Before I start, though, drawing our river bend, I'll show you my tools. All I use is a soft leaded pencil and a tiny sharpener to keep that sharp when I want it sharp, and a kneaded eraser. These erasers can be shaped into any shape you want to make them, so that if you wanted to just erase a small pin dot area, you could. That's my tools. And of course I have this nice rag stock paper. All right, we'll start I always like to start with a horizon line, or what I call a plane to build a picture on. And I'll sketch in this start establishing our river bend coming around that, from that plane, bending around once and then coming around the bend that we saw. Now the background, we'll make simple mountains for now, just to give us a sense of background. And with that, we've set our scene. Now here on the inside of the turn, we have a gentle slope, very sandy, gentle slope, and that goes down, if you recall what I said, it goes all the way down to the outside of the turn, where it's more of an undercut bank. But before we do the outside of the turn, I'll add some stones on this slope. And the closer to the water the stones, the more rounder they'll be, because that's during spring runoff or during high water periods, they would be inundated and part of the stream bed. And then the further up we go on the bank, the more angular the stones will be. Just make them more squared off and ragged as we go up. Have our stream pass by these hardwoods. Give us a little mid-ground detail. We'll put some hardwoods on the sandy bank here, up far enough where the ground is becoming more stable. Like this. And eventually we can, in a little bit, we'll put details in on those. Little stone up here on the sandy bank, back down to the water. Now, with the inside of the turn established, we'll work on the outside of the river bend. And this is where the water shifts to the outside of the turn and starts to dig away the outer bank. To make this water look still and deeper on the undercut, we're going to put little bits of detail, like I'll put this boulder that has just fallen down, say, into the bank or just sitting there perched. And then I'll suggest the reflection of it right in that still water. You see that? Here, this highlight, work on the highlight here. This highlight of land, see, we can just suggest a little bit of a reflection of that in the still water. See how that looks like it's being reflected into that pool? Here, I'll show you another one, a more drastic one. Here, we'll darken up another eroded chunk here, and we'll make a nice big piece of land to reflect into the water. And we'll do the same thing, the same angle, but only backwards into the pool. See? See that? Oop, I went a little too far. Sometimes you get carried away when you're drawing it. There. The more we work on those reflections, the more still that water will look in this far side of the pool. And the deeper, consequently, the deeper the water will look. I'm not going to go any further because I want to put some overhanging. Well, let's start now. Where this water comes around, remember the deepest part of that turn, it starts to undermine the vegetation and trees and everything start to grow inward and lean toward the water. So we'll put in a nice, say, some kind of alder or something coming in here. Well, we'll put in a few like this, leaning in into our picture. I squint when I draw. I don't know why. Do you? I can see the picture more intently if I squint when I'm looking at the lines I draw. You do what you have to do. See, I'm going to define those leaning trees a little better. Maybe I put in one good big tree coming in over here. A nice thick tree leaning in off of this outer bank. See, by doing this, we could actually suggest this whole outer bank without having to draw it. Now, before we go any more on the outside of the bend, I want to establish the inside of the bend a little better. And this slope, in order to make land look gently sloped, it's nice to bend shadows over it. So I'm considering that we have a light source coming from this angle, and I'm going to use every possible thing on this slope to give me that angle of light shadow. You see that? We're going to do this. This will be a long shadow part of the day, let's say. But you can see, you start to make those shadows just sort of gently wrap around that piece of land, and it'll slowly start to take a nice shape to it. It's great when you have something tall that does throw a long shadow like these trees, and I'll just bring that shadow right around this piece of land like that. Each one of these boulders has to be shaded in the same fashion. The more we shade the things on the piece of land, if you can see that as I work, the more the piece of land itself starts to get a shape to it. You're not only giving shape to the things on the land, you're giving shape to the land that they rest upon. Let's see, maybe should we make this a big boulder? We make this a big angular thing, and of course we'll come down and round out more as we come toward the water here. There. See, before I leave that outside bend to go to the inside to work on, I want to just establish some area here where we're going to have a lot more shading to where this water wraps around this bend. I'm going to put these reflections in. I don't want to finish this water. I just want to establish this area where these trees' reflections will be in there, because this is the deepest part of the bend underneath these trees here. And the more reflections we show, the stiller the water looks, and that really... Yeah, that's all I want to do on this side for now. Except maybe I might as well bring a fish up to the surface. It looks pretty good here. There's a water ring. I want to show you a trick. When you do a ring on the water, wherever your water area, wherever you're drawing your water and it's a light area, you make the ring with a dark line like this, see? And wherever your water ring is over a darker area on the surface of the water, you have to use your... Can you see there? You have to reintroduce a little bit of highlight over there like that. You can see that. The more I... If I can get that... There, see? See that little bit of white? Now watch. I'll work around that white area of the ellipse. See there? See that? Just like that. That's a ring on the water. Here, I'll put a little bubble in the middle. You know what that means? That if you're a fly fisherman, a little bubble in the center of a rise form means the fish took something off the surface, because as he gulped something off the surface, a little bit of air come into his mouth with the thing he ate, and then as soon as he goes back under, the air expels through his gills and makes a little bubble right in the center. So there we know a fish just came up and took something off the surface. That's as much as I want to do on the outside of the bend. Let's go back over here, back to the inside. want to show you again how to use little line accidents, I call them. So you say you're doing this and you're just giving some texture to this, and then suddenly you crisscross a few lines. Well, that's where you start adding texture. You start using the way your lines have naturally fallen on the paper and just delineate a few of them, and you end up adding a few textured boulders there. And see that? A lot of artists call that making use out of accidental lines. Painters are expert at that. There we go. Okay. We're going to bring, now there, you see, this was our slope. And remember, I walked down and down and down, and right about here I got my pants wet. Well, we want to make sure that slope is understood in our picture, but we do want to draw over it, because really what we're doing here is detailing the surface of the water, but we still leave that slope line in there, and we bring our water around and let it wrap around this river bend. Like that. You see that? So that slope line is still visible. You see that? You see that? That slope line is still visible under the water. As our water comes working its way around the river bend here. Over here, we're going to start to hit some shallow water, so we're going to riffle it here. When you're drawing water, moving water, you should always try to make your lines go in the direction of the water flow. That gives it a sense of movement. Like this. See, I'm coming around this bend out of the stiller water of the turn, and I'm going to start to ripple. And, of course, since we have shallower water and we have riffles or disturbed surface, we have no reflections to speak of from these particular land objects which are right next to the water. However, we will be seeing stones under the water surface. So that's where we start to draw around stones under the water surface here. And you don't have to worry about making them very visible, because it's just the way when you're at the stream. You have to look a little hard to see the stones when you're walking along the real stream. Why should a person be able to look at your drawing and see things so clearly? Like, make them work a little bit. Make them look for the stuff in your pictures. In fact, I'm going to put one good size boulder here, right in the middle of the stream bed. See that? But because the water's flowing this way, I'm going to wear the stone down more on this side and have it more angular on the back side. So here, this has been the part, the front of it's been beat by the water a little bit harder than the back. In fact, this is where one of those quiet pools forms, right behind the stone. See that? There could be a fish hiding behind there. You could draw a shadow of a fish in there. They like the back of those boulders, quiet water back there. See? The water. Now, if we just left this a stone be suggested at the surface of the water and no further, it would look like some kind of a shell floating on the water. So we have to bring it down into the bottom of the water, into the bottom of the stream bed with the rest of these stones here. And we have to suggest that stone goes down. Otherwise, it's going to look like it's floating. Here, I'll put another boulder. Of course, every time you add a boulder, you have to suggest another section of quiet water behind it, like that. Is that making sense to you? It certainly makes sense to me. It looks like the stream I was walking in. I don't know what you were looking at, but I saw this stuff. Yeah, this is clear water, nice crystal clear trout stream. You can see the stones in the bottom, and at the same time, you can see the surface rippling by. And, you know, the light is coming from this way, so it gives us a hint to everything we shade has to be shaded on the other side of the light direction. Here, I'll make this a nice still surface. This is the quiet pool behind that boulder. Nice quiet pool there. Look how quiet that looks. Still. It really does. And then, of course, the other quiet pool behind this one. And right about here, I want to put an obstruction in the water, like the one we saw when I was coming into the riffles. We'll put a submerged stump, or a branch it'll be. So here, we'll suggest a branch under the water. This is going to be embedded under the water, actually, you know, from time and silt. But the thing we want to highlight is one branch of it will bring up. See, this is a submerged tree, and of course it's going to be weathered and water-eaten under there. But it's laying in a way that has one of its branches sticking upward. And that branch sticking up will be our obstruction in the surface of the water. We'll bring the surface of the water around this obstruction, and then we form our pool of quiet water behind it. Remember when we saw that? So this is how we're seeing how the water is flowing. Remember, I told you, by showing on what side of obstructions and boulders the pool of quiet waters form, then that's how you can tell which way your stream is flowing in your picture. So we'll put our pool of quiet water behind this obstruction, and we'll shade the obstruction up here in the light. In the light, it will have much more of a harsh shading than it would underneath. Underneath, it'll have a much more diffused shading. And we don't really care too much about this underwater part right now anyway. We just want to show that that's where this particular stream obstruction emanates from. And in fact, to make sure that we put this part of the branch underwater, we're going to take the eraser and just knock out a few pieces of it. Do you see that? You have to start with something solid before you play with it. So that's why I'm saying we drew it in total, and then you take your eraser and knock it apart a little bit to show that it's under the water and not on the surface of the water. Here, let me do a little bit of work. It's what you do with the surface of the water that really makes the difference. In fact, remember the bubbles? We can add a few bubbles behind here. That the bubbles behind that obstruction indicates that that's a pretty sharp flow of water right there. Over here, I won't put any bubbles because that's a gentle wraparound effect when it goes around those boulders, those exposed boulders, we call them. But here, this is a pretty sharp little piece of twig sticking up, and I want to make it look like the water is faster over on this side, so I'm going to add a few bubbles as that water goes by there. In fact, the surface of the water, before I go any further here, remember I told you about a fish rising over here. The more rings I put around this, the further back in time I place that rise. Because as you know, when you drop something in the water, it widens and widens until it finally dissipates. So the one way to suggest that in a drawing is to add some rings on the outer part of the initial circle on the water. Before I do anything more to this obstruction sticking up here, I want to add a jumping fish to the picture right here. I don't want to do much more here because the fish may take up some of our room. So I'm going to have that fish, well, let's say this is the surface again. We don't want to have him, this is going to be where he'll be coming out.
surface of the water on the same elliptical plane as these. And here we'll have our fish coming out of the water. Fish rarely leap this way out of the water, but you know, they do, and it makes for a nice drawing for today. But we'll have him coming out for a reason. This is going to be a trout. The other day I was out fishing. I didn't catch anything while we were out getting this picture into our head, but the other day I was out fishing, and within about 2 hours, I caught what I call the finny trinity. That's one brook trout, one brown trout, and one rainbow trout. And whenever I do that, I just stop and go home. That's like having a perfect score bowling, you know, and if you stay and do another game, you're a nut. You go home when you get it perfect. Okay, there's my fish leaping out of here. The fish isn't the main subject in our picture today, but it is going to give us more interest in our water scene. I want to get back underwater here with them again. See, why I want to get underwater is because the fish will actually help us define our water. This is the reason the fish was jumping in the first place. I'm going to put a mayfly here. You watch them when they're flying, all their legs hang down like this, and then those wonderful tails, you could barely see them. I can see them though, I look for them. There's our mayfly. This is why the fish was coming out of the water. But we're not really talking about fish, we're talking about water. But I can't get myself off this fish. Let me finish just a little bit on the fish, okay? Make me happy. I tell you what, I'll talk about the water around the fish. You know, when you see pictures, sporting pictures, where the fish is jumping out of the water and all this splashing is going around on the surface, that rarely happens. When a fish leaves the water, it cuts. Its body's built for moving through water, and it cuts through the water, no splashes. The splash may occur when the fish belly flops back down, but we're not going to show any disturbance on the water as this fish comes through. We're going to put a few bubbles around here. But you see? This makes it look real. This is natural. Fish just kind of slices through the surface of the water. There's no splash. Underwater bodies, you don't have to detail the same way you would bodies that are, or things that are above the water in the direct light. So for the tail of this fish, we're just going to suggest it in shape. Just the way you would see it. You wouldn't see every detail of a fish's body underwater. But you see, just enough. And of course, we'll take that shape and wrap it with our stream here to make it blend it into the movement of the water. See that? Right like that. And take that shape up here and blend that just a little bit into the movement of the water. Like that. In fact, we can take this and break up that body. Can actually break that body up. So there's not a complete outline around it. That kind of keeps submerging the figure underwater yet. The more you break up that
complete outline, the more it looks like it's under the water and not on the, not above. You can work on these, this shading all you want too. I mean, you can shade until this gets so lovely and so smooth. See that? Now that we got the fish on the surface, out in the light, and we have the fish, the part of the fish that's under the water. It's very clear in the picture. There, that's very clear to me. That fish is jumping out of the water here. And underneath him, I'm going to start putting these round boulders again. See, there. Round boulders on the either side of this obstruction, this sunken branch. In fact, the fish would throw a shadow, I believe, over the over this, even though it's underwater. It would throw a shadow across this obstruction underwater, the part of the branch that's under the water here. That gives us some shape for that. And the obstruction itself would throw a shadow on the bottom of the on the stream bed. And I think this is turning out. In fact, I'm going to start wiggling these stones here because this is all riffles again down here, and I don't want it to look like they're too clear. I'm going to get that broken tip of that obstruction. Okay. Now, we'll get back to that, but I want to come back inside here and come into this last part of the picture, which would be this side of the inside bank of this tern. And actually, I'm just going to suggest some a grassy bank on this side. There's some grass with a, some grass and seed there. But you see, we just want this to be boulders, you know, some big stone, big boulders, big moss or grass-covered, earth-covered shapes, just to give some form to this side of the picture, to kind of give us that full wraparound feeling of the stream, just as if you were standing up here on this bank and seeing this picture unfold. In fact, what the heck, we might as well put this, put an old stump over here. This might have been the thing that broke and fell in the water in the first place. Let's just say for the heck of it, this might be where that occurred, that original break occurred. Some stones around it. These stones don't have to be round. These are up on the land. Okay, that'll give us something to work on. Now, this is where the land, the edge of the land is, and this is part of the, this will be part of the bank still under here, where it's still cutting out as it's turning around. Now we're seeing the backside of this cutout effect. So now we have the opportunity, we have this whole beautiful open area to just shade in and suggest nice dark still water with reflections. So let me do that. See, I'm going to complete these reflections right here. In fact, I'm errant on one reflection. I know. I don't know if you've been watching and noticed this, but you see this tree up here? What the heck do you call this? Look at this. And this is reflected. Kind of an artist am I. I better put that back down. Now here's a good example of still water being disturbed. I'm going to draw this reflection of this tree. Remember, this tree angles this way, so I'm going to angle my reflection the other way. So, but look, watch, I'll do this much of the tree nicely reflected with no break in its reflection. But suddenly, where this trout ring, see where the trout ring disturbs it? It breaks the reflection up, and it gives that sense that the water is moving in that ring, and it breaks up the reflection of this one tree. In fact, I can continue that right over here, right in the middle where the water is moving, and then suddenly where the water gets still again, I can make that reflection solid again. Just shading the surface of this stream now. And I want to look at how you use the shading on the dark surfaces on the surface of the water. You use the dark areas in a drawing. You can use them to your benefit by bringing them up to what you want to look nice and white. Look here, this, see that belly of that fish? I want that belly to stick out a little bit. So I'm going to bring that shading right up to the belly of the fish. In fact, I can even make right here under his chin. Stand that up a little bit. Stand that out. See that? The more you do that, the more each thing in the picture starts to become integrated with other things in the picture, and then you have a more solid, natural scene. You could do this here, even just for this blade of grass, just to bring one blade of grass out a little bit. Just shade right around it. Bring the surface of the water around this grass. This is where it all starts to pick up again. You can correct any line. See, some of my lines were going this way and that way. And you can correct them with overall lines in the direction of the flow once you finally establish your shading areas. Like that. You can see shade behind the grass and pick that right up. Pick up the part that goes on top of the grass right out. Like that. Down here too, I can do some more of this this tail. I'm going to use a little modeling on this fallen, sunken branch to the bottom side of it. And when we get that in, some dark shading on this part of the flow, and I would say we've got our picture. That's a picture if you ask me. Anytime you bring the surface shading of the water over an obstruction or a stone or a boulder or a part of a body like on the fish, you are putting those things under the water. And when you don't bring, if you bring your shading up to, see here, if you bring your shading up to something and stop at that something, like here, see the top of that boulder is clearly above the surface of the water. You know, you can probably touch up a picture forever. I think I'm going to just figure it's done. Well, there we have. We covered all of the things and features and aspects of water that we saw today and that we walked through. And it happened right here on our paper, the way I described it to you and showed it to you and drew it for you. I hope that next time you draw water, it'll come a little easier for you because you'll have certain things to think about, certain guideposts to judge your observations on. Next week, will be drawing land. And I think that if you put up with me this week and slog through all that water, and enjoyed it, even at that, next week you'll enjoy it even more, because we'll be high and dry and we'll be doing a landscape. I think I have my picture here. I'm going to sign it. I'm going to sign it and figure I'm done. That's one of the nice parts of doing a picture. I just, when you're finished and you know it's yours and it came out of your head and from the things you've seen, well, then you deserve to put your name on it. There.
Drawing from Nature is made possible in part by a grant from the Lintilak Foundation. Jim Arnosky is the author of Drawing from Nature, available in bookstores and libraries nationwide.
For more classic programs, visit vermontpbs.org/fromthearchives.